The north and east shores of Samos are littered with splashes of orange. These are the life jackets refugees leave when they land on the island after a grueling crossing in total darkness that takes several hours. What they need first is to make a fire to warm themselves up and show where they are. Then it's to the harbour, Fatti, where the police will provide them with a pass that will enable them to continue their journey. MSF asks locals to let them know when they see boats approaching so they can assist the refugees as quickly as possible.
I've just had a call from a volunteer telling me that a boat has just arrived. So I'm on my way with first aid supplies and water and biscuits too. Once the refugees are all okay and back on their feet, they'll be taken to the harbour.
Le bus il est avec nous. On amène des gens et ensuite dans la continuité on arrive.
When the MSF nurse arrives to offer first aid to refugees who have just landed, Gabby, a volunteer who lives on the island, is usually already there. She hands out dry clothes, water and biscuits to the families and toys and cakes to the children. Gabby and a dozen others have been helping out since the summer. Incapable of standing by as 1,000 or so people a day arrive on the island, they decided to get organised.
Yeah, we just try to be there as fast as possible so we can help also to pull the boat on land, helping the people out, say one welcome, one melaba, and then try to do whatever we can to give them the first help. We have some people here from the village who just pass by every day and ask, can we help? So we pack some diapers, we collect some toys from the children. So the group is constantly growing.
The bus hired by MSF then takes the latest arrivals to Vati Harbour. There are around 2,000 people here, waiting for permits. It takes at least 4 or 5 days, but often more. The lucky ones go to hotels, while the others sleep here in containers, tents or on the ground. All they want is to continue their journey.
My plan was going to Netherlands, frankly. I'll go there. But you know, there are a lot of steps before you reach Netherlands. It's a long trip, but I'll make it. I get afraid because I hear the rumor that they will not let us to go to which country that we want to go. But I hope it will be a lie, not a truth.
Spaghetti. Meanwhile, groups of volunteers get together in the morning and at noon to distribute food to the refugees. Since the beginning of August, Yorkesti has been cooking meals for several hundred people every day.
We start to cook for 30, only 30. We go there and the other day we cook for 60 meals, 100 meals, 200 meals, 300 and 4,000, you know.
Once they get the white piece of paper authorizing them to continue their journey, the refugees board the ferry to Athens. The crossing takes 9 hours. This is just the beginning of a long trek. Buses await them to take them to the border with Macedonia. Then it's Serbia, Croatia. They move fast. They know Europe is closing its borders and turning back is quite simply not an option. When violence broke out yet again in Bongi, inhabitants fled to the displaced persons camp at Empuku Airport or to other sites where people have assembled, like here in Benzvi.
In most of the camps, the biggest problem is hygiene. There are 3,000 to 4,000 displaced people in each camp, and as there aren't enough shelters for all of them, many of them sleep outdoors. We're not able to meet their most basic needs. It's hard for everyone, and people are turning up every week, Not that many right now, but we're concerned that if numbers keep increasing, we really won't be able to cope.
MSF runs mobile clinics where they offer treatment to the displaced. Stagnant water in the camps attracts mosquitoes, so treating malaria is a priority. Respiratory infections are also common. But for these displaced people, poor living conditions are the price they have to pay to be away from the violence that could flare up at any time. The Ebola epidemic is over in Sierra Leone, but certain precautions continue. Washing hands with chlorinated water is the best way to keep the virus at bay. It's become an all-essential ritual for anyone entering the MSF clinic where Ebola survivors receive treatment.
How the house, how the family? So, what's the problem now?
Well, the problem now is because when the virus starts from the team, they feel like cool.
Does it come out?
Abbas Kanu is one of Sierra Leone's 4,000 Ebola survivors. Most survivors suffer from the same complaints: painful joints, chronic fatigue, vision or hearing impairment, but also depression and post-traumatic stress. But it's hard for them to get treatment. People still fear survivors.
I cannot use. Wait and count me now.
When I was discharged, I came back home and I couldn't do anything for 3 months. I was unable to walk, unable to do any jobs. I couldn't even work until MSF came and started treating me.
In neighbouring Guinea, there have been no new cases since the first week of November. As at last the epidemic appears to be coming to an end, Abbas and the thousands of other survivors are still in need of medical care. At the end of the 1990s, people infected with HIV in the developing world were finally able to join in the race alongside all those already living with HIV. Compared to 15 years ago, first-line AIDS treatment costs 100 times less, and the number of people with access to it has increased 50-fold. Scientific advances and developments in medical care have resulted in a drop in AIDS-related deaths and new cases of HIV infection. 15 years ago, only those already suffering with AIDS and severely weakened by the virus were offered treatment. But since September last year, the WHO recommends that anyone infected with HIV should begin treatment as soon as possible after diagnosis, as this increases their chance of survival while reducing the risk of the virus being transmitted to partners. There are even predictions that the end of the AIDS epidemic may be in sight. Sadly, it's not that simple. Of the 35 million people infected with HIV and who should therefore have access to treatment, there are still 20 million who don't. And starting treatment is only the beginning. Take the example of someone living near Lake Victoria in Kenya's Ndiwa district. HIV prevalence here is among the world's highest, with one quarter of the population HIV positive, and two adults in every 100 becoming infected annually. This inhabitant of Ndiwa has been able to get a diagnosis and has been offered treatment, but he must remain vigilant and he needs the support of the system. Thanks to effective treatment, the viral load in his blood has become undetectable. It's so low that tests can't measure it. But if he doesn't receive support with persevering with his treatment, if his and his medical team's vigilance lets up, the consequences will be disastrous. Not only will the virus start replicating again, it will also become resistant to the drugs used to treat it. Without appropriate medical supervision, such as routine measuring of the level of HIV in his blood, the medical team won't have the information they need to adapt their treatment strategy. And even if they do, there's yet another hurdle, as second and third line treatments are more costly, or often quite simply unavailable. Our patient, who had an undetectable viral load and was in good health, falls sick again. And once more, he's at risk not only of transmitting the infection, but also of dying. MSF has thus decided to take action in Ndiwa on all aspects of the disease, from diagnosis through to treatment follow-up, so as to ensure nobody falls out of the race. Simplifying treatments, offering routine, individualized support, adapting care strategies to suit each person, this is what is required to allow people living with HIV to persevere in the race against the disease.
I've just come back from almost a year of working with the Syrian population, whether it's the displaced population in Turkey or more precisely, most of our work is concentrated within the confines of Syria itself. And what I can say is that since I've arrived, the situation unfortunately has just deteriorated for the worst. The bombing is just indiscriminate and ongoing towards the civilian infrastructures. Unfortunately, what we're seeing as well is that the medical structures are also caught in the lines of crossfire. We have medical structures that we have been supporting for many years that have been bombed now almost a dozen times over the last year. It's just incredible. People unfortunately cannot flee anymore. The borders are closed. People that had fled initially within the confines of the borders in Turkey, in Lebanon, or in Jordan now feel that there is no possibility for them to return to Syria anytime soon. And this has provoked over the last 2 years, and especially over the last summer, this mass migration of population towards Europe. And the ones, unfortunately, that are still within the country are the most vulnerable. They're the ones that don't have the money, that were not able to flee to Turkey or Jordan or Lebanon.